I don't even know how to shut up.
All right, let's call the meeting to order. Mrs. Kelly, roll call, please.
Bates.
Yes.
Illingworth.
Here.
Kimbrell.
Here.
Patterson.
Here.
Westerholz.
Here. Let's please all rise for Pledge of Allegiance, moment of silence, and let's acknowledge that today is our Flag Day.
Yes.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
America, we love you.
Now for a moment of silence, please. From the preamble of our Colorado Constitution, we the people of Colorado, with profound reverence for the supreme ruler of this universe, in order to form a more independent and perfect government, establish justice, ensure tranquility, provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. Thank you. Please be seated. May I have a motion for approval of this evening's agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Here.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Westerholz.
Aye. I want to thank everybody for being here tonight. Got a good crowd here. It looks good out. And besides, it's nice outside tonight. Thank you all for coming. So, as we enter into public comment, next. Please be aware that any personal or individual student matters are considered confidential under Colorado law. And it is out of respect for the law and our employees and students that we require those discussions to take place privately in executive session. It is requested that individual comments be limited to 3 minutes or a total of 15 minutes for a particular topic. The intent of public comment is to give the Board of Education the opportunity to hear your comments. However, the Board will make no decision or take any action on public comment during the meeting. Mrs. Kelly.
Well, this evening we only had 6 people sign up, so all 6 will have the opportunity to speak tonight. And the first one in order is Nate Owen. And just be aware, when there's 1 minute left, I'll say 1 minute and then time.
Good evening, Board of Directors and Superintendent. Thank you for having me here tonight. For those of you that don't know, I'm Nate Owen. On May 24th, 2022, this board, alongside with WPEA, signed an MOU demonstrating their commitment to ongoing collaboration with educators in this district. Let me read this memorandum of understanding out loud for those of you that might not have had the opportunity to read or hear about it before. It is the desire of this board and this administration and WPEA to review strategies over the next year to consider a long-term plan of good faith collaboration between WPSD and WPEA for the benefit of the district. This commitment expressed in the Memorandum of Understanding shall address needed transparency and ongoing improvements of constructive communication between parties which are dedicated to ongoing and intentional points of connection. We believe that we have the opportunity as a collaborative to rise above external factors and to build a bridge which will strengthen our collective organization for the support of all employees. This brighter future is a real commitment for all parties to continue the great work of WPSD and aim our sights towards the excellent education of tomorrow's youth within the district. Some tactical examples that could result from this collaboration may include bullet point number one, that two-way communication is valued. Number two, the good faith that professional expectations are being displayed. Number three, times for ongoing and intentional dialogue are happening. And number four, opportunities for stakeholders to be heard. Signed on May 26th.
Of what year?
2022. In the memorandum, it says it shall expire June 30th of 2023, which is here in about 2 or 3 weeks. This MOU gave me hope that this board truly wanted to hear educator voices. It is a constant source of frustration to be tasked with elevating educator voices to this board and have the exact opposite of this MOU happening regularly in my school district. Our district previously engaged in the meet and confer process for over 40 years, and when I inquired about this, I was told that there was going to be a new quote-unquote educator voice program. To date, no additional information about this has been made available, and this was on April 17th when that happened. During our normal meet and confer process, we established mutually acceptable staff working conditions. These working conditions are our students' learning conditions. And by skipping this process this year, you are failing educators, parents, and students. In the MOU, you said you would rise above external factors. In the way you spoke about educators during the last board meeting, many of our staff felt targeted with the political labels such as communist, Marxist, and socialist. This does not promote a culture of safety or trust in this district. Educators and staff who work in Woodland Park schools are the heartbeat of this district. We are the people who interact daily with our students, parents, and community members. Many of us have been given dedicating many decades of our lives to this district to make it a truly exceptional place where our students can thrive.
How much more time do you need, Nate?
I have about two sentences.
Okay, go ahead.
They're a little bit longer sentences, but they are two sentences. This board's actions have shown that they don't understand or value the work educators have done in this district. Educators deserve to be valued as the experts in this work and to have a voice to be heard in all decisions made here in Woodland Park. Please honor your MOU, bring back meet and confer, and listen to your staff. Otherwise, you can't hope to attract, support, and retain the highest quality staff that foster an exceptional, positive, and empowering work environment. That's what the policy used to be.
Thank you.
Today I come before you to discuss a matter of great concern and urgency in our community. It is with disappointment that I address the decision made to not sign the grant for mental health services. This decision carries significant consequences for the well-being of students, families, and the community as a whole. Mental health is a critical aspect of our overall well-being, and it is directly impacts the life of youth. As we are all aware, the challenges people my age face in today's world are immense. They grapple with academic pressure and social dynamics. By denying to sign the grant for mental health services, it is not only disregarding the needs of us, the students, but it's also neglecting our emotional well-being and stopping our ability to thrive, not only academically, but personally. It is essential to acknowledge the grave consequences of ignoring mental health in our education system. Research has constantly shown mental health directly correlates with academic pressure. When students are burdened by untreated mental health issues, their ability to concentrate, learn, and engage in the classroom suffers immensely. By refusing to sign the grant, it is undermining our educational foundation of us, hindering our potential, and undermining jeopardizing our future. Furthermore, the decision not to prioritize mental health services sends a troubling message to our community. It implies that the mental health well-being of us, the students, is not a priority, and that our struggles should be overlooked or even ignored. Such an attitude not only portrays stigma surrounding mental health, but it also undermines the importance of seeking help and support when it is most needed. We students deserve better. We deserve a superintendent who recognizes the significance of mental health and who is committed to providing the resources necessary to address it effectively. The grant would have provided access to vital resources, such as counselors, therapists, and programs aimed at supporting students in need. These services are not luxuries. They are essential for the development of youth. It is crucial for us to stand up and raise
our voices
against this decision. We must come together and unite as a community to express our concern, advocate for change, and demand the mental health needs of students in Woodland Park are met. We cannot allow our community to be left behind in this critical area of support and care. By standing up, we send a powerful message to superintendents and those in position of power that mental health is not a matter to be ignored or brushed aside. We highlight the significance of investing in mental health services. If we do nothing, the consequences will be grave. Thank you.
Thank you, Erica. I really like to hear it when students come and talk. I appreciate you doing that. Thank you.
Right, the next one up is Carol Barrett, retired educator.
That's it, Carol Barrett, retired educator. Started teaching in 1965, all the way to 2012, from sixth grade in California to preschool and adults getting their GED in Pennsylvania, Western PA. What I want to say is that my main concern is for all of the children, not only in this district, but every district across the entire United States. I'm highly concerned about the way things are going, the things that are being taught to them that shouldn't even be mentioned in their presence at the age that they're being taught. So I'm thankful that this board is geared towards a good education for our children, for protecting them from things that are beyond their age that they shouldn't have to hear or see. I just thank each one of you, and I want to support all of you in what you're doing in this school district. Thank you.
Where in Western Pennsylvania are you, from?
Beaver Falls. Joe Namath.
All right, the next speaker on our list is Drew DePatty, parent.
Do you know where we are in the history of our nation? Are you aware that our country and our community is hanging in the balance, and you have a big role to play in it? We have a small but well-organized group of extremists in our community who have incited a rebellion among school children, incited an insurrection and left school children without teachers for the day, aggressively approached young women after school board meetings with hostile union thug tactics, swatted a spouse of a school board director, called for the imprisonment of a school board director. Does this sound like normal political opposition from people who may share similar goals but differ on the way to attain those goals, as has been traditionally the case in American politics? No, it doesn't. These are unhinged extremists who continue to hurt the children. This situation calls for an appeal to the Attorney General of the United States. The U.S. Attorney General, Merrick Garland, is an intelligent and accomplished man, as evidenced by the nomination by President Biden and the approval by Chuck Schumer's U.S. Senate. I want to call your attention to a memo he issued on October 4, 2021. I have a copy for each school board director. In his memo, he outlined the increasing threats at school board meetings from extremists who are intent on disrupting public proceedings, intimidating elected officials, and even worse. He called for increased coordination between the FBI, and local law enforcement. And now, thanks to recent whistleblower testimony, we know that the FBI has infiltrated school board meetings all across the country since that memo was released. Has the FBI been to Woodland Park, coordinating with local law enforcement? If not, why not, since it is surely justified at this point? And now, according to news reports, the extremists have put forth three candidates to turn back the clock on all the progress the school board has made. If they are elected, on day one, these fringe candidates will reintroduce gender confusion to young children through SEL. They will bring in anti-capitalist civics education.
1 minute.
And boy, would they just love to see Merit Academy burned to the ground so they can celebrate with their radical big union bankrollers. Up until now, it has been nothing but incoming, relentless, vitriolic attacks. We need a real plan to push back against the extremists who are hurting the children. I urge the board to appeal to Attorney General Merrick Garland to get the resources we need from the Department of Justice to push back against the rise of political extremism in Woodland Park. Thank you, Mr. President.
Where else did you do comedy at? See your show so
hey.
No more interruptions.
I didn't realize I was interrupting something. I was
you are.
Making a comment.
Yeah, he's disrupting the meeting.
I'm disrupting? Excuse me? No, I'm going to stay and listen, actually,
Logan,
because this is about the budget. So.
Logan, could I talk to you for 2 minutes?
Go and talk to Tim first, and then he'll decide whether you can come back in.
I'm going to sit and listen.
Then we'll have to call the police and have your...
All right, go ahead and call the police. Oh. I'm going to sit here and listen.
All right, our next speaker is Lorraine. Is it? I'm not sure how to
yes,
pronounce
it. Merle. I'm sorry, I have arthritis.
Okay, Lorraine Merle.
Thank you.
I don't think I'm going to stay here. You're interrupting the meeting more than I am.
I don't want you to be interrupted, so
okay.
let's just wait just a moment.
I'm here for a public meeting, and guess what? It's about the budget, so I'm a public taxpayer. Legally, I'm allowed to be here.
Would you please just step outside and talk to him so the meeting doesn't continue to be interrupted?
I'm not interrupting right now. You guys
yes,
are the
are
ones interrupting.
Yes,
you are interrupting.
He's a taxpayer.
I am a taxpayer.
Oh, God.
So, I don't pay taxes on my salary from you guys. So.
David, why don't we go ahead and adjourn until this is
okay.
Yeah.
We're going to take a recess. I'm going to call the police right now.
Okay.
Sir, for the budget process, there are no comments from you. You're here to observe.
So I, you have to go outside of the room to observe.
No, you need to be quiet and listen.
I don't understand why me making a comment when I wasn't interrupting anything is problematic.
Sir, you are interrupting.
I'm not right now. You guys are the ones stopping the meeting.
You're still talking.
I am talking because if they're talking to me, I'm responding to them.
We have to adjourn. It's adjourned temporarily.
No, it's not adjourned, actually.
Well, he did. So we can all.
Who's Tim?
Tim.
Tim, that guy was.
I was trying to.
You think he's going to eat that space?
He was sleeping the other day, but
yeah,
yeah, he was interrupting Justice Mike by handing out his papers.
roll call again?
No. We're still in the meeting. We just can't use this.
All right, on to our consent agenda.
We
did not finish public comment. All right.
We have two more.
Come on down.
Give me 1 second here just to gather my thoughts with all this going on.
Take your time. Take five.
Do you want
take
a cookie?
5 minutes.
Do you want some cookies?
So, my name is Lorraine. Some of you know me and some don't. This is the first time ever I have never prepared anything because I've never been pulled out of the ask it before. So there you go for not being prepared. But let me get straight to it. I always like to stand out for the positive, and I'm trying to think how I can do that tonight. And I'm going to start by standing out for the positive where Mr. Westerholtz, you talked about the students, how important that is to get up and speak. I am all for that, but I think about last meeting, how many students were locked out with me. And I'd briefly like to talk about what happened because all of you were in here. And as I don't know if any of you noticed, but I've been coming to this meeting forever, sitting in that spot, but now you've changed. So I'm not too big on change, but what happened last time is I always used to get here at 5:25. I was always the first or second in line. I'm sure security cameras show that. And the last meeting, I said to get here early, try and park a little bit closer to the school. I got here at 5, and I could not get in. And so I was very confused of all the people that were in line. So with my personality, I started asking people out there, what happened? How did you know to get here so early? Because I guess I missed something or a memo or something. And the people were very honest to me, and I am so grateful for that. They would tell me all the things. I said, do you have kids in the district? No. Do you live here? No. Do you have family here? No. And these are the people that I spoke to coming in, or the
one
people
minute.
Or the people that were going out of this building. And I don't understand that. I heard that there was communication. They told me there was some kind of announcement at the Bible school. And that's okay. We're all free to do whatever we want. But I don't understand that, because three of you up there that I've spoke to in the past, your first question out of your mouth was, do I have kids in the district? No, I'm a grandma. But I've lived here for 26 years. And finally, when I got in, when you guys came back out of your recess for the, and I said to you, Mr. Westerholtz, please tell me why you locked me out tonight. And you said, I can't talk. I said, Mr. Westerholtz, tell me why you locked me out tonight. And you said, I can't talk. And so my question to you, why you said that twice, is who hushed you? And then I said, please, Mr. Westerholtz,
time.
You and I have had a good relationship where we can talk. And you finally opened up to me and just said, because there were overflow rooms were closed because we didn't know how many people were going to attend. Who on earth would ever know how many people are going to attend at a public meeting? That is my point. I feel that was wrong. Thank you to everyone for your time.
One for public comment is Khursheed Rogers.
Hi, my name is Khursheed Rogers, mother of two kids in the district that has been opposed to the actions of this board. I am not an extremist. I am not an intimidator. I am not a radical. I am not vitriolic. Tonight, I would like to speak about my confusion. Confusion about the events during and since the last board meeting. And any clarity you could provide would be greatly appreciated. First, I was confused about why you didn't let the public know beforehand that there would not be an overflow room for the first time due seating, overflow seating, due to fire code. It would have helped us greatly to know that. I was confused about the letter to the editor by a board member stating that those of us outside were offered a live stream of the meeting in the auditorium. I was outside and I never heard that offer. We were offered seating in the commons, but there was no mention of a live stream. And that offer was made after the meeting was well underway. I was also confused about how at the DAC meeting it was stated that those of us outside were trying to pry doors open. I was right at the doors when the attendance line was cut off, and I can say sincerely that I did not see anything of that sort happening. And just FYI, though there were a lot of emotions happening out there, I will say it turned out to be a remarkable display of people listening to each other despite differing points of view. Continuing with my theme of confusion, during public comment, I was also confused. I heard a parent state that they were happy about Merritt students receiving bus transportation to school. And I heard that parent acknowledge that Merritt families were paying the same $50 for busing as the rest of us WPSD families.
1 minute.
And I heard him ask whether the remainder of the per pupil busing fee, which is much more significant and is paid for by the district, if it was also equal between the charter students and the students from the five other schools. My confusion lies in the superintendent's response to this question, which did not address the essential question, but rather restated that families are paying the same $50. It doesn't feel like a difficult thing to clarify, so maybe that could be done tonight. I was also confused by comments at last month's meeting when each board member stated their reasons for extending Mr. Witt's contract as superintendent. I heard that by refusing the mental health grants that were serving our students, Mr. Witt stood up to socialism. Yet in the same speech, I heard that he implemented free lunch for every child. So my confusion was, why isn't free lunch considered socialism?
Time.
This is a genuine lack of understanding on my part, and any clarity would be appreciated. I have more, but that's time.
How much more time do you need?
I don't know. I have a paragraph left.
One paragraph.
Another thing I was confused about was why Nate Owen, as the WPEA president, was not afforded an opportunity to speak. Were he given that opportunity, the public could have had an opportunity to hear that the WPEA did not stand behind the CEA's anti-capitalist statement. By not allowing him to share, while you took the opportunity to express your opposition, it felt not in the spirit of partnership with our teachers, and it actually felt really opportunistic. Finally, I'm confused by the press releases you are choosing to post on the district website. I don't feel that the sources are unbiased or fair. Thanks.
Is that it?
Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for participating. Next, we will move on to the consent agenda. Do I have a motion to approve our consent agenda this evening?
So moved.
Have a second.
Second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Westerholtz.
Aye. Next, discussion and information on our public hearing for our budget. This is Ryan.
deal with it.
Okay, good evening. Tonight I had assistance setting up projectors, so that was helpful. So we're going to discuss this year 24 budget for adoption as published in the Gazette last week. So in your packets, if you go to...
Can you talk into your microphone a little bit better, please?
Okay.
The people watching online, and I can hear you better.
Okay. So we're going to discuss the fiscal year 24 budget for adoption as published in the Gazette last week. You can find the PowerPoint presentation in the yellow tab. And then the green tab in your file is the actual budget that you received last week. So much of this information was already discussed in our May 10th meeting, so a lot of this is going to be a repeat. The first slide is the total revenue and expenses for all funds with the comparison to the fiscal year 23 revised budget. So we're projecting an overall decrease in revenue of $1.4 million and a decrease in expenses of $2.4 million, which means we're $1 million favorable compared to fiscal year 23. You'll notice the year-over-year change in grants of $2.4 million. $1 million of that is due to the decrease in ESSER, since ESSER 1 and 2 will be closed out. Food services is increasing in both revenue and expenses due to the increase in the number of meals due to the free healthy school meals for all program and the addition of merit to the program. Transportation expense increase is due to the standard annual increase and not to the addition of merit. And this has been determined to be a centralized shared service, so every child has equal opportunity for transportation. Mr. Wood, did you want to say anything more about that?
I guess I would just reinforce, since there has been a number of questions over the last few weeks, we believe that the Total Opportunity Initiative is critical to making certain that every Woodland Park student can attend the school that their family wants them to, subject to capacity limitations, but not subject to transportation. It is a district centralized service, and the district will provide that service to all Woodland Park students.
Okay, so the general fund revenue is increasing $414,000 for the year, and then the expenses are decreasing $139,000 compared to fiscal year 23. But you can see our expenses do exceed our revenue by $2.9 million. We're going to go into the next page in the presentation, following along at page 3. So this is a breakout of the $2.9 million that we may need to draw from our reserve. So we have the different categories. We have capital, which includes $1 million of capital security, and then other capital projects of $1 million. Salary and benefits of $461. All of these are one-time expenses that are not part of our normal operations. We have an additional $400,000 for curriculum. And then we have $110,000 in other areas. We have one-time legal expenses of $50,000. So we already have in the budget our normal run rate. This is an additional $50,000 since we're anticipating higher legal expenses due to the change in our education program and personnel. So, any questions on that so far?
I do have a question about the ESSER funds. That is something that we did, what? That's something that just phases out, it times out. This is not something that we're not accepting, it's just that it's going away. Is that correct?
It's a deadline. The ESSER 2 ends September 30th. The ESSER 1 has already closed out. So now we have some, we have ESSER 3 left. I think it's about $800,000 in the budget for ESSER 3.
One of the other things that I wanted to ask, and maybe you know the answer to or not, our reserve, that reserve funds that we have. Typically, what does a typical public school have in a reserve fund if it has reserves? Is it like 5-10%? Do you know what the typical would be?
So if you're talking about our contingency that we have to budget,
yeah.
So we have in our general fund for next year, $25 million of expenses budgeted, and we have $8 million of contingency.
Okay. All right.
So. To answer your question, if I may add, it's very common for school districts to have 8 to 12% reserves, healthy reserves. Woodland Park has substantial reserves in excess of that, which speaks to the financial strength of this district. But it also means that we have opportunity to make some long-term, one-time investments to the attention of security and to the attention of some other areas in the district, and we absolutely want to continue to make the right improvements in Woodland Park.
Thank you.
Okay, I just want to talk about here that we do have some opportunities that we may not need to use the $2.9 million. We were conservative in budgeting. In budgeting our property tax revenue, since we use the assessed valuation, the same assessed valuation as fiscal year 23, and the assessor's office is estimating an increase of 14 to 18%, so this could lead up to $1 million of additional revenue. And then we also may have carryover in our capital of $500,000 from fiscal year 23. So instead of the $2.9 million, we may only need to draw $1.4
million.
Wonderful. So next we're going to go into more detail on the revenue. On page 5 of your packet, it's just for your information. It lists each of our funds in a description. Then on slide 6, is our assumptions, and again, we already explained the assessed valuation is the same as fiscal year 23. The per pupil rate is $1,000 higher than fiscal year 23 at $10,168.60 per pupil. And the funded pupil count is 2,246. 0.8 of which 400 is merit. So basically we're projecting a flat pupil count compared to fiscal year 23. So merit increase is making up the decrease in our other schools.
I just want to understand that. So our per pupil funding, is staying the same, but it's because of the increases in our other, in our sixth school.
They're offsetting the decrease in the others. Okay, so next we have the general fund revenue detail. And the first two line items are calculated using the per pupil assumptions and result in a total increase of $2 million compared to fiscal year 23. And that revenue does include merit. So the allocations include capital projects with $1 million dedicated to security upgrades and an increase in the charter school allocation due to the school's expansion. You can see the total revenue after allocations is 414,000 higher than fiscal year 23. And then next we have the revenue distribution. So the total local revenues are 53% of the revenues, of which 14% is the local sales tax. And then the state revenue is 44%, federal 3%. And then this is a breakout of the allocation of $3.1 million of sales tax collected by the city and redistributed to the district. So that's how we're spending the money. Page 9. Okay, next we have the general fund expenditures. So the fiscal year expenditure, or 24 expenditures, are budgeted $138,000 lower than fiscal year 23, and this even includes a salary and wage increase of 5% for all employees, plus $1,500 signing bonus for all new employees, and $1,500 bonus for all returning employees. So the average total increase per employee is 8%, if you combine those. And then we also have, we discussed this before as well, changes in our benefits. So the medical insurance coverage remains the same, but the cost is significantly decreasing in fiscal year 24. And this savings has allowed us to triple our life insurance coverage and expand the employee assistance program to cover all employees, as well as professional liability insurance for all of our teachers.
I do have a question, just for clarification. If last year we gave an average of...
It was like around 10.
10. What was the average wage salary increase last year?
Wasn't it 8.5%. And then on top of sign-in bonuses.
And then sign-in bonus.
I was here for... I wasn't...
Like 12%, wasn't it?
It was average? Around 10 from what I heard, but I was in the audience, so that's what I remember.
So... Plus this year, an 18% increase.
5% increase in salary as well as $1,500. So one time as well as salary. That's
I like that. Let's keep that up.
We'll try.
If we can.
Let's keep those raises going.
So I do want to let you know that SROs are not included in the budget, since the city has told us that no SROs are available. So we don't have the resources.
The city doesn't have the resources.
The city doesn't have the resources to offer us.
Right. It was not a matter of us not being able to meet their price. They simply have a manning issue.
And that's a student resource officer, just in case anybody doesn't know.
School resource officer.
School resource officer.
That's what I said, school resource officer. Which is security. So, but we have a great one standing by the door right there.
Oh, yeah. So when you're looking at the year-over-year comparison column, you'll see that $500,000 more is being allocated to instructional compared to the other areas that all have decreases. So basically, we had some cost savings in the other programs that were able to offset the increase in instructional. Page 12 is the general fund cost object comparison, and you can clearly see that we are allocating 3% more to salaries and benefits compared to fiscal year 23.
Very good.
I don't know, I think more money is good.
Yeah.
Does anybody agree more money is good?
Yes.
Pays those bills.
Okay, slide 13. This is a general fund program allocation. So if you add up the instructional, school admin, and special education, that equals 66% of the budget, which is the same as last year. The only difference is that we're adding an additional 1% to special education, and the school admin is decreasing 1%. And all the rest of the percentages are similar to last year. For fiscal year 23, I should say.
If I may just make one statement, the takeaway there is that we've worked hard to reduce overhead and increase investment in our classrooms successfully.
That's great.
Okay. Slide 14 is the appropriation resolution. So this includes all of our expenses. You'll see the general fund is the $25 million of expenses plus $8 million in contingency. And then slide 15 is the specific budget resolution. So these are the last two pages of your actual budget packet in the green tab. We already discussed the general fund, $2.9 million. And then the bottom section includes the fund balances for all of our other funds. So what we have left in our budget calendar for fiscal year 23 is for the board to adopt this budget, hopefully today. And then the deadline for adoption or for approval is June 30th, and it goes into effect on July 1st. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Don't leave.
Thank you for your presentation.
So let's open this up for discussion about the budget.
It's an action item, a motion.
But in a second. Is there any discussion?
Yeah.
I'd just like to say I look forward to approving this budget here in a few minutes. Having reviewed it, it's great to see that the revenues are going up. I notice our transportation costs are going down. I'm especially pleased to see that in light of our desire and your stated intention, Superintendent, to basically focus and prioritize on academic success. I love to see things like a reduction overhead and that money then being reinvested back into the classroom, not just in sort of educational programs and curriculum and things like that, but of course, in supporting our valued staff, our teachers, our counselors, our paraeducators, all of our educational professionals. So I'm very pleased to see that we're continuing to be able to give raises for the second consecutive year. Mm-hmm. And only question is, since it goes into effect on July 1st, is that when like returning employees would get the bonus?
They receive the bonus in September.
September. Okay.
They need to have started instruction.
And then also when the increase goes in on terms of their next paycheck.
Amy, keep me honest on this one. It's the July paycheck, correct?
Yes, the 5% will be in July, and then the $1,500 is September for return.
So 5%, just for everybody who's watching,
5% increases in July in paychecks, and then the 1500 is in September? Okay. Thank you.
And then we have $2 million allocated for capital projects. A lot of that is security upgrades and things like that. Are you able to speak generally, Superintendent, about some of the capital projects that you're hoping to be able to accomplish in the district over the summer?
Yes, very briefly. We've allocated a significant chunk to security investments, which we won't go into detail on those in this meeting, but there is an executive session to detail some of those thoughts. But also safety, not just security, and that includes we're committed to a project at Gateway to improve the safety of students walking in and out of the area as they approach the school, adding a sidewalk and some better traffic control there. We're making some investments in the facilities themselves, some facility upgrades as well. And I would have to say that some of those facility upgrades are also related to security. So I'll leave it at that.
Okay. All right, thank you, Mr. President.
Nick. You know, I was not on the board last year when the 8.5% raises came through, but they were a long time coming. The teachers hadn't had a raise in 6 years. And my only hope was that we could continue that to have quality educators up here. And I'm very pleased to see what was presented in the budget. And we are continuing to appreciate our educators and try to provide them a good income and support them to educate our kids. So I'm very encouraged with what was presented.
Mr. Ryan, what was the increase for special education? You said there was an increase. What was that?
1%.
1%? Okay.
Within the standard
of the
day. 1%.
1%.
Special education.
No, just special ed. Happy to see that.
I was really glad to see whenever things can be streamlined, done more efficiently, and I think that we've done a good job presenting that in our budget this year. I think there are some things that I would, and I think the rest of the board would agree with, that we have to address is increases security throughout all of our schools. So I look forward on working towards that this year so that employees, parents, teachers, students, that everyone comes into the school and we minimize as much as possible any kind of threat from within or without. And I assure you we're going to work diligently on that. I look forward also to increasing our streamlining that we can keep on giving our teachers raises each year so that we can retain and hire the absolute best for our school district. And then with our continuing upgrades to our facilities that I really would like to see that this school district is not just the shining part of the shining city, but the premier education location in this Pikes Peak region, and I think that we will work hard towards doing that. And I think this budget is a good first or big step in that direction. So, any other comments?
Usually, you see budgets increase, so it's good to see a decrease in this, especially while you said we're investing more in our classrooms and in our teachers at the same time.
So I'll just say thank you, Superintendent. Thank you to Ms. Ryan and all of your really dedicated and hardworking staff for getting this done and being able to find those places where we need to increase the spending and also those places where we can and are able to decrease the spending. I think this is a great, great new way that implements this refocused prioritization on our students, their education, and our professionals. Thank you.
Any other comments? No, there being no more comments, I would like to have a motion to approve the 2023-2024 budget appropriation resolution as presented.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Are you seconding or are you asking?
No, I'm asking for a second.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Resterholz.
Aye. Specific budget resolution number one. I need a motion to approve the 2023-2024 specific budget resolution number one as presented. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Resterholz.
Aye. I now need a motion to approve the resolution that is titled Designate School District Election Official. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
That one needs to be read, Mr. President.
What is
it? It can be read after seconded.
Okay. I'll second, and then can I read? I'll go ahead and read.
Please read it.
Thank you.
Okay. Resolution Designate School District Election Official. Whereas the Board of Education of Woodland Park School District RE2 in the County of Teller, State of Colorado, shall conduct its regular biennial school election on November 7, 2023, as provided by state law, and participate in the election coordinated by the County Clerk and Recorder of Teller County. Therefore, be resolved, the Board of Education designates Kelly Haven to serve as the school designated election official for the 2023 regular biennial school election. The school designated election official shall perform election duties on behalf of the Board of Education. The election official also has the authority to cancel the election and declare the candidates elected by acclamation if, at the close of business on September 5th, 2023, there are not more candidates than offices to be filled at the election, including candidates filing affidavits of intent to be write-in candidates. So that's it.
We have a first and a second on the table. Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Resterholz.
Aye.
Congratulations, Kelly.
Yes.
Thank you once again.
Kelly, how long have you been performing those duties?
Probably 16 years.
Yeah. Wow. How's your season? Just another walk around the park for you.
Yeah.
Okay, on to letter D, to cancel our July regular board meeting of education. Do I have a motion that we cancel July's regular board meeting of education, Board of Education meeting? Now, that's normally what we do. We normally don't have a meeting in July, but we have to officially cancel it, just so you know.
Motion to approve.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Resterholz.
Aye.
And I'll just note that's one of those things that we also regularly do because so many of our employees are on vacation at that time, and it's a little bit of easing a burden on them as well.
Thank you. Roman numeral 8, Board of Education reports.
Information.
Say it one more time.
That's just an information report. They're non-discussion items.
Right. Does anybody have anything to say? Is that what?
Okay.
Sure. I got something. So at the last DAC meeting in preparation for the budget, the DAC was discussing the budget. And one of the things that was a subject of discussion was the safety of our crossing guards and, of course, the safety of the students who are crossing the streets with them, chiefly on Kelly's Avenue, where Columbine, Middle School, Merritt are. There's three different crossing spaces there, at the intersection of Kelly's and Rampart, and then in front of Columbine and also in front of the middle school, where there's a, I can't remember what the road is called, but the Wilderness neighborhood is there. And so we had a gentleman on the DAC named Mike DeMuth, who's really taken a personal interest in this. He has children who attend the schools there, and so he participates in drop-off every day. And I know at the DAC he told us that he went and talked personally with each of the crossing guards, at least there over at Columbine and the middle school crossings. to kind of get feedback from them and what they thought. And so he had some great ideas that he brought to the deck. But one of the things that turned out, as great as these ideas were, was there was sort of little for the school district to do. Like one of the great suggestions that we could do is get like bigger stop signs for the crossing guards to carry that have like the flashing lights on them, sort of upgrade the equipment they're using. But the main ideas really went to the street itself, which we don't have any control over, the city of Woodland Park does. And I'll just share that the ideas that were discussed and generally supported by the DAC were, A, we have a speed limit that changes there. So if you're driving past Columbine towards the middle school in Merritt, the speed limit goes up from 20 to 30 because you sort of cross out of the school zone of Columbine, you enter this free-for-all zone that you get to go 30, but then it seems like within 20 yards, you're entering the middle school zone and you're going 20 again. And the general consensus is that the crossing there at the middle school and the Wilderness neighborhood is probably our most dangerous because you have cars that are accelerating and now having to decelerate versus when you get to the intersection, you've already got a stop sign coming there. And so all those cars are generally stopping at that four-way. And so the suggestion is if we could get the city to change the speed limit so that it's 20 between Columbine and the middle school, essentially from that intersection at Rampart and Kelly's all the way until you get past Columbine, that would generally be 20. That whole thing would be a school zone. That would be 20 whenever it's a school day and school's in session, not on the weekends.
For its length.
Right, for that portion of it. So you don't have this weird up and down. The other suggestion that was given was perhaps having some sort of speed bump as you approach the middle school crossing there. And then one of the things that the city has done in response to some of these concerns is that right near the end of the school session, they had put out like a flashing speed limit sign. So as you're approaching the middle school, this thing's gonna flash you and tell you, hey, if you're not going 20, you need to slow down. It's gonna tell you what your speed is. Similar to what we have, on 24, like around McDonald's and Sonic. But this is a temporary sign. It's like on a little truck. And so the idea would be, could we put in like a permanent flashing sign there? Maybe a permanent one over by Columbine if you're approaching from Highway 67 or something. So those general three things, which would be designed to overall, during school time, slow down traffic and the interest of promoting the safety of the children and the crossing guards, the volunteers, or the employees. So what I would ask, since that's going to fall on the city and their budget, is if Superintendent, you or another member of the administration could reach out, like perhaps to the city manager and their administration, and see sort of what their appetite is on this and whether they'd be interested and could do it. I think it's something that would be great for the community, certainly great for the children attending the schools and our crossing guards, and in keeping with our focus, especially during this budget season, of safety and security.
That sign was originally posted down at Columbine and then was moved after a couple of incidents. I like your idea of that's such a short span that the speed limit goes back up. That sign is very effective, and I think it helped when it was moved. But if it were reduced to 20 for that duration, I think that would be helpful. But those flashing signs are very helpful.
I think they are too.
Right, and just to not take any credit, not my ideas, were ideas of Mr. DeMuth and some of the other people at the DAC, and I was there as one of the board members that sit on the DAC, and I thought they were great ideas, and I think the consensus of the DAC amongst all the members was they're great ideas. And so just need to see what we can do to work with the city and make those concerns known to the people who are in a position to pay for and make those changes. So.
Thank you, sir. Any other directors have a comment?
Okay.
At this time, we will be going into executive session. So, I need a motion for us to adjourn to executive session for specialized details of security arrangements or investigations pursuant to Colorado Revised Statute 24-6-402-4B. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson.
Aye.
Resterholz.
Aye. This time I'd also like to invite our attorney, Brad Miller, to join us in our meeting.
David.
For those of you who stayed, we had a great meeting about school security. I think we're making good progress in that direction, some good research and things, so I think you'll all be very happy with that. So, no decisions were made, just a lot of good discussion, a lot of good research, and so we will tonight we'll adjourn. Do I have a motion to adjourn tonight's meeting?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Bates.
Aye.
Illingworth.
Aye.
Kimbrell.
Aye.
Patterson?
Aye.
Resterholz?
Aye. Meeting adjourned. Thank you for coming tonight. Allie, have you come up? Where do we donate?